we are back today in the book of Acts, chapter 15 today. Left off in chapter 24, verse 22. Last time. I'm going to read verse 22 again to get to see what's happening. If you remember, the people in Antioch were being bothered by some of the, what we might call the Judaizers, the legalist crowd that had come down from, supposedly from the region of Judea. So, whether they were from Jerusalem or just that way, anywhere else in the region of the area of Judea, they come down from there, down into the area, telling the Christians that in order to be saved, they needed to pretty much basically become Jewish. They needed to, they realized how to be circumcised. They obeyed the laws of Moses. When you're going to obey the laws of Moses, just that statement right there alone opens up a whole bunch of instructional items for the scale of the rules. You know, the mandatory feasts where you had to go up to Jerusalem, and you were supposed to be there and you made the body, all that would have been included. Barnabas were there, and he said, hey, that's not right. That he sharply disagreed with them. He said, no, that is not what you need to understand. What Messiah did when he came into the world was the same thing. He was the Lamb of God that fulfilled the law of Moses. He fulfilled it. It's all been brought to head, and it's been all accomplished now. That all the requirements of the law were now complete accomplished. We no longer owe the law. But you guys don't understand that. Jesus taught that this was the way it was going to be. He was coming not to abolish it, but to fulfill it. And he was the way of God, as John the Baptist said, that takes away the sin of the world. That's what Jesus was, the way of God, the sin of the world. So, anyway, they need a little bit of clarification. If you won't just believe us, then let's go and let's put the rest of the apostles in on this. And the elders in the church of Jerusalem, and let's have them lay it, give you their opinion, and we'll come back. Remember last time I talked a lot about does the local church have to have the okay and all that stuff from the headquarters group? No, we really don't. I believe the New Testament church models told us that the individual local groups are to be us, but self-ruling, agreeing with that system. But it is great to have a network of churches that you know believe the same way on the same page, and we can share people and events with them. So we belong to a group like that. We call it an association of churches, though it's not necessarily a denomination. That's why sometimes in the year we've said, well, it may say Baptist somewhere outside of the building, but we really are a denomination church. We belong to association churches. So, we are what we call us here, which makes us a denomination of believers. So, anybody ever asks, that's where we stand here. So. But anyway, now let's get back to this trip that Paul and Barnabas made up to Jerusalem. And they spoke with the elders. Peter got up and talked, and James got up and talked, and then he was giving the instructions here because James had become the leader of the church there at this time. He wasn't even going to be alive. In fact, during Jesus' time, he didn't even believe in him because he's little brother. Can you imagine growing up with big brother? Can you imagine what Mary and Joseph were always telling the other boys? Why can't you be more like Jesus? He's perfect. I must think hard living in his shadow. Yeah. All right, so let's pick up verse 22. Then the apostles and elders, with the whole church, decided to choose some of their own men and send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. They chose Judas, called Barsabbas, and Silas, two men who were leaders among the brothers. All right, so sending these two men along would be like sending witnesses, right? So there's a couple of witnesses
that I can use the picture to attest to the fact that when Paul and Barnabas bring this letter, it really is from the brothers, the apostles Peter, the head of the apostles, the James, the head of the church of Jerusalem. So, this is their opinion. This is their ruling coming out of this. Their view, like I said, the church could have said, well, we're going to do this anyway, right? And they could have done it. They were wrong to go that way and do the law of legalism. And the church did eventually develop as it became their own complete Catholic, or Catholic peace. They became the one Catholic church, like all the Catholics, I believe, one Catholic church. You can see that claim in the Catholic. It's okay. That's the word for this one united church. But when they started that, they had a headquarters, and it really started kind of changing things. And they got some great things. And here's a list of the things that they wanted to do. Anyway, so back to sending these guys along, they will attest to it. So now we'll read this letter, starting in verse 23. Just look at 23 and 25 first. With them they sent the following letter. The apostles and elders, your brothers, to the Gentile believers in Syria and Cilicia. Greetings. We have heard that some went out from us without our authorization and disturbed you, troubling your minds by what they said. So we all agreed to choose some men and send them to you with our dear friends, Barnabas and Paul. Setting the stage. I like that. Without our authorization. Does that happen sometimes? If you ever been in a group of association or something like that, and someone goes out from them and starts representing, supposedly, and speaking for supposedly all of you, right? That doesn't work too well, does it? You end up having some disagreements with things. You can't go out and represent us. So there are people that are authorized to speak for our body, and you're not the one. So don't do that again. This is kind of what was happening. They went out from them, and they were not. And this letter starts off with, I want you to understand, they didn't represent us when they brought that to them. And also, like, what he put in there, disturbing. Right? So this was, we should read this as, this legalism disturbed the Gentile believers. When you think, I mean, ladies don't have to worry about it quite so much. If you're a guy, and you've decided you're going to be a Christian, and you're part of this new church, and this is the new rules, they're setting up a clinic in the back, and everyone's got to get circumcised, right? And that's just not something that a grown man looks enough to get through. And that would be a deterrent. In fact, I know a lot would just say, I'm not going to join people in that. I'm not going to do that. I don't think God requires that of me. I would have been Jewish. Born into it, you know, that kind of thing. So, anyway, and many, you know, there were cultures around the world, even part of Rome, where circumcision of baby boys was a practice, just like it was with the Jews. There were different groups around the world where they had practiced that since way back, but not all. And many of them, Gentile means not Jewish, right? It's just any other nationality other than of Israel. And most of them probably didn't practice that. So now it would have to be done as an adult, as a person who came to the Lord and, you know, baptized as an outward profession to the people, you know, that came out of this faith. But I can't do that. Anyway, so it was disturbing news. I mean, I like the way that was in that letter. Because I see, I'm disturbed personally by all forms of legalism when it comes to Christianity. Anytime you start introducing any form of legalism into the true gospel, I'm disturbed by it. I'm like, a group that does that. I know that some of you might have wondered why we don't necessarily do some songs anymore. You know, but it wasn't good. This church has, we have cut out some of the songs. The reason is because of our copyright licensing. When we do a song, there's a record of that, and it counts whenever we do a song here the church, and some of it's paid royalties, right? Through our licensing every year. We get paid royalties from that. So, in fact, if you're paying royalties for a song that was done and owned by a group that has a different gospel, they've introduced legalism or what have you into their gospel message, then you are supporting that by singing those songs in the church. Now, if you sing it at home or you hear it on the radio or whatever, if you're not paying anything for that, whatever, you sing it. I'm sad, you know, some of them are really good songs, but you miss getting the royalties from that. It's something we should care about. And so, I don't know if you like to visit the same churches sometimes, but if you're going to do that, you're going to pay an offering and give it to an offering that supports a certain church. Check out what they're teaching us first and see if you're supporting the true gospel or some other gospel. Because, you know, you're potentially in that wickedness as Paul said, if you do support that. So anyway, now let's get back to verses 26 to 29. Speaking of Paul and Barnabas, men who have risked their lives for the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, we are sending Jesus and Silas to confirm by word of God what we are writing. It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us not to burden you with anything beyond the following requirements. Pause at the end of verse 28 for a second. I believe, my opinion, that consider my opinion, I'm not being dogmatic about it, but I believe that that was it. Mistake using the word requirements there. I believe in the original language the letter said, you have the following requirements. The word in the Greek that was used could easily be also referred to as recommendation. It could have been translated following recommendations. Just putting that in there so that you can understand this may not have been hard requirements. In fact, I know it's not. I think other things have been contradicted by other things that they said in other places. So, especially in Paul wrote in some of his letters. So, verse 29. You are to abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood from the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. It would be well to avoid these things for a pretty short, sweet life, right? But like I said, I don't think that that was called requirements because then, you know, it would be a requirement to be in the Christian family, you know, in the church that we should avoid the sexual immorality, but the blood thing, where do you draw the sure, I think it's healthy and it's probably good to butcher the animals and bring that stuff out of there and clean it before you cut up the meat. But you never can, especially with beef. You never get that meat. Some of it is there. I like mine a little bit on the rare side. Personally, you know, some of you are like, oh no, it's well done for me always. I do. I kind of like the beef and rare and a little bit of my side. If I occasionally have a stick, that's kind of where I like it. So some of you people just tell me that, oh, you're crossing the line with that. You can't be a Christian when you're saved. Right? Now, I'm going to have a sharp disagreement. That would be disturbing for someone to come to this with this news that was not authorized by Jesus. Right? I think Jesus would join me with that statement. I really do. I think he would say, well done, my good faithful servant. Judas and Silas were to confirm that Paul and Barnabas, who had risked life and limb for the gospel, and they had, we've already read about some of them, right? alone and they left and died still. So they risked life and limb for the sake of the gospel. So these guys are saying, you know, we need to listen. These guys, Judas and Silas, are there to confirm that Paul and Barnabas are speaking the truth here with us. And you will do well to avoid these things. Farewell. Simple as that. We have nothing to add. Later on, one of Paul's letters, he'll make reference to this, that he also went up to Jerusalem later on and presented himself to the brothers and said, this is what I teach. This is the gospel message that I teach when I have been. They have nothing to add to it. They blessed me. Prayed for him, considered how God has represented him. He had authorization to represent the church as he ran. He's one of the people that can say that. So now let's look at verses 30 to 32. The men were sent off and went down to Antioch, where they gathered the church together and delivered the law. The people read it and were glad for its encouraging message. Judas and Silas, who themselves were prophets, said much to encourage and strengthen the believers. So, encouragement, by the way, seems to be a big key word in our case, encouragement. Because disturbing is the opposite, that's discouraging. This good news to Gentiles about the gospel being not legalistic and is by faith alone was encouraging. It is. I don't know about you, but I think it's really encouraging because you can introduce a possibility of losing that salvation because you didn't keep the work, right? You didn't do it right. You had that grace or something like that, or whatever the case is, you didn't go along with the legalism, and so your salvation has been forfeited. Is that possible? Not according to the New Testament book. It's not possible. Because it's not by works. It's by His work, and not mine. So, that's the biggest reason I do, that there's many places. And I think Jesus gave us the parable of the wayward son, right? The prodigal son, we call him the one. I think that was to tell us that you never stop being the son. Once you're adopted, and he also talked about us being grafted. Well, that's now a permanent thing. You're adopted and you're grafted in. And all the language throughout the New Testament makes this a permanent thing. And even the picture of baptism, it's a new creation with a new creation. Are you going to be thrown back in your world right now? Not if the old one's been buried and put away already. How are you going to get it? There are churches out there in our own community who teach the soul. That if you start believing, he'll take away your salvation. You were at a church with a group of young teenagers, a youth event at one of our local churches, and a couple boys were being roughhousing like they do sometimes. They're not that tall with them, between the water fountains and things like that. I had gone there, I was busy. I had gone there to make them quit, but stop that. But one of the ladies there that was part of that church, started scolding and getting on to him. And she says, did you do this other thing? Or something else? She was accusing him. One of the other boys was saying, and they didn't. I said, no, we didn't do that. That wasn't us. Don't lie to me. She said, I wouldn't believe them. Said that they were lying. And then got in their face and said, if you lie to me, Jesus will erase your name from the Lamb's book of life. You talk about some disturbing news and disturbing teaching. I'm purposely not telling you what church that is. Because I know personally that at the time it didn't represent the belief of the pastor. But it does represent that denomination, their position. So you need to catch these things. You need to understand these things. And what are you supporting if you support that ministry? That's why I said earlier about the elephants. This is a different gospel. If that salvation is something that you can lose because it's based on do's and don'ts, and if it's based on do's and don'ts, then you probably could lose it. but it's not basic. I am thankful that I was taught right, and I was shown in Scripture the true gospel. Over and over and over in these 37 years, more, 35 or 6 years that I have been involved in ministry. I've studied this time and time again. Every time a little bit of legalism starts creeping in, I investigate the Scriptures again. Do I have it wrong? I want to make sure I don't have this wrong, because how do you want to teach right? And sure enough, the Lord shows me doing it again. This is the right gospel. It's not legalistic. It's not based on your gifts and beliefs. It's just based on faith in you. You trust him. He paid all. He paid some of it even for you so that you can comprehend God's things. Now, it's when it's done, and the Holy Spirit baptizes you into the body of Christ. Symbolically, we say that that's symbolic thing, our baptism teaches that, but really, spiritually, that is what has happened. And once you've been immersed and submerged into the body of Christ, you're part of the body of Christ. And no surgery can come along taking you out. You might be removed from a church if you start disrupting too much, and they might say, we prefer you don't be around here. Unfortunately, sometimes that has happened. But all of my days, word to say the code of every other time. I need to take the code of that. So, anyway, this is not the picture of a legalistic gospel. It's quite the opposite, which is encouraging, right? It disturbs you in the past. So, I hope you're like me. You're disturbed by that kind of gospel. But remember, encouragement is a key here. It's something that we should be about. Encouragement is a way of encouraging God many times in the New Testament. So if the council had tried to add a bunch of law to the gospel to make the Gentile believers have to begin observing rituals and rules, it would have not been very encouraging. Right? They would have Paul later writes and said there's other letters being brings a different gospel other than what they, the apostles, have presented. It's to be rejected as human. Do not listen to them. Do not accept it. So, some churches today present a different gospel. Yes. You have to kind of look for it sometimes. They might be very nice and funny people. You might really care about them a lot. But you have to take a look at them. Whether I care about them or not. To support the true gospel, tell people to come pray to salvation. Because what's happening is that people out there think they're saved or not. Because their faith is based on what they've done. Faith is based on their works. And the object of their faith must be in Jesus Christ. That's the object of our faith, not the fact that you're It's not based on. Legalism is widespread in the Christian world. We are to avoid it. We have the freedom to abstain from eating meat, or to worship on Saturday, or to observe the Lord's Supper every week if you wish. You have the freedom to do that. But to teach other believers that they must do these things in order to be saved is blasphemy. Because it's what Jesus said. Salvation is paid for by Jesus on the cross. Remember that. Anything you do in order to live a holy life and draw closer to the Lord, show yourself to others, is evidence of salvation. Sure, but it's between you and God. It's not required for salvation. It's what happens after the salvation. It's the fruit of it. We should show evidence of our Jewish life as proof of life. But how we go about that is between the Lord and verse 33 to 35. After spending some time there, they were sent off by the brothers with the blessing of peace to return to those who had sent them. But Paul and Barnabas remained in Antioch, where they and many others taught and preached the word of the Lord. You might wonder, why those verses 34, if you're reading that book, in the NIV, the numbers say 34, God says 35. Okay? We've gone over this before in other places where Scripture does this. And the modern translations have tried to correct it down what was there before. Remember the verse numbers and the chapter numbers are not inspired. They were a rubric that the church back in the Middle Ages put in about the time the first English translation was written. So when the English translation was written, numbers were put in. And that's where we get, you know, 15, 33, 34, 35. And if there was a statement that was written, it was in a manuscript that was used to make this translation. But then, as they find through archaeological digs and Dead Sea Scrolls and other things, they find older manuscripts of the writings, right? And things like that. When you find older manuscripts, and that phrase isn't there, then you have to say, well, that means sometime after this, someone put it in. And it should be there. And so you correct that by the way, most of the Bibles are probably all in the footnote down at the bottom, where it says 34 in parentheses, and it will say some translations include the phrase that Silas stayed behind. What does it say? That Silas decided to stay whatever version that's all it adds, okay? But it's kind of redundant because later on, I mean, it just said that Paul and Barnabas stayed there, and the disciples remained there, and they and others stayed and preached. So, anyway, just remember the numbering was put there before the modern translations were done. And it was not inspired. So if you translate right, the phrase is pretty much what you do with that number. You might think that you want to make a footnote to explain why to people. If you want to throw that in personally, you're in Bible, okay, but Silas stayed. That's really all I need to say. Why don't you go back to the Jews? All right, let's look at verses 36 to 38. Sometime later, Paul said to Barnabas, let's go back and visit the brothers in all the towns where we preach the word of the Lord and see how they're doing. Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with him. But Paul did not think it wise to take him because he had deserted him in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in their work. So, verse 36 says that Paul asked Barnabas to go out again for this mission. If Barnabas hadn't traveled back to Antioch with Paul, it would have been much later before they would have had been in a personal conversation with one another like this, where one could say, hey, you want to go with me on the trip? So, we know that Barnabas was in the same team. The NIV says for some time later. But the reason is that because the original makes it a vague amount of time. It didn't say how many months. Was it a whole year later? Or was it a couple of weeks? We're not told. It wasn't recorded. Some time later. So we just put that in. More important note is that this dispute that Paul and Barnabas are about to have. So let's pay attention. Remember, John Mark, who may believe is the mark of the Gospel of Mark, which, by the way, Mark was not one of the 12. And you might wonder, why is it the Gospel of Peter? Well, many believe that the Gospel of Mark is Peter's Gospel, because it seems to be told from what would have been his point of view a lot of times. So, we also know that this Mark was an assistant to Peter in the text, too. And so it might have been during that time where he wrote down the Gospel of Mark. Peter just said, yeah, here's what it is, but don't put my name on it. So Mark wrote it, he put it together, just like Luke was gathering the information for his Gospel,
Also, the book of Acts, he wasn't one of the 12, he had a few other people who got the series. So, I've been the other way around. I'm not really going to take what said it was Peter's gospel. That would have been kind of an incorrect thing. A lot of people would have said, well, that's the way the others did it. Because Peter was a man of God. They could really change it to work. So I think he's saying it's the first book. The shoes of the fisherman. It's a phrase he chose to consider. Peter was that fisherman. Verses 39 to 41, they had such a sharp disagreement that they parted guilty. Barnabas took Mark himself for Cyprus. The Paul chose Silas, commended by the brothers to the grace of the Lord. He went through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. For some reason, Paul was really upset about this leaving. He deserted them, is what the scripture says. So somewhere in their trip, they must have needed it, and he decided to hightail it through. And so Paul was like, you can't really be counting on it. He's flaky. That's kind of like what he's thinking. The guys are flaky. We'll get out there and be right in the middle of something, and he'll take off again. No, I don't think we need to take him off. Probably not. But Paul really, he felt very strong enough to where he would split ways with Barnabas, whom he loved being with, right? But this really was possibly, we have to look at this and look what was going on from the helicopter view of how the church is being built, what's happening here, and what is the Holy Spirit up to. Sometimes people have to have a little influence from the Holy Spirit to disagree with something small like this in order to obey the Holy Spirit to move the direction that He wants you to go. You see, it might have been Paul's desire to hang out with Barnabas. Barnabas is my buddy. I want to hang out with you. And the Holy Spirit might have been saying, you guys need to divide the book. You guys need to go out and get the people to say, because you can speak, Barnabas can speak, and both of you can go out in separate parties. And do this, and it might have been something that we like to have together. And not really obeying the move of the Holy Spirit. Maybe. I'm just, this is conjecture. Right? I'm just saying maybe it was something like this. But it happens in life too. Sometimes the Lord's going to light up fire in your seat to get you to get up and move. And that's kind of the sort of thing that I'm wondering if that might be what goes on here. Because they were still great friends, and later on, Paul does travel with Mark. Takes him along with him, gives him another sign. Just not this time. What is this a story about? The Spirit moving to the sky. Who knows? They split up. And I'm sure there were times along their separate trips that each of them really missed the other. Probably did, but the Lord was using this little disagreement between them to divide and multiply. To the groups. So, should we necessarily see every split as well? So, sometimes the Lord says, now, I want you to split off and go and do this and do that. Go and start up another church. Some people may not like it. If the Lord has ways of going out to heaven to conquer more territory, right? And that's the way the church grows. Sometimes the Lord uses these little splits and things like that and plans to multiply the effect that we have in the world. Some people say, why do we need so many churches? If all believe in the same Savior and we all have the right gospel, we can just have one big mega church, right? And maybe this county only needed one Christian church, and we could all drive to a central location. I know one of the places is doing that. It closed down several of their locations and bought some property in the building. So they could all come together like that. Well, what does that do to the gift that people are giving? When the Holy Spirit gives gifts to the different people in the church, the Christians, you've got
a couple of people that have a gift they have the same gift while they don't really need the blessing. They might need a backup from time to time or something like that, but they only need one passive teacher in the church, right? Unless he needs a vacation. And someone needs to step in for him and spell him off like that or something, but you might only need one in church with that gift. So what if you have four of them in one congregation? What do you know? The others just help you out to another exercise of gift. Or do they split it up? Or how does that work? Why not have smaller groups where they can have a closer effect on smaller group people? You know, I look at the, and we see if we look in church history, the early church was small churches. That's really how it spread so far. A lot of them were house churches in people's homes. Or just, you know, you've got someone that is after becoming a Christian, now the gifts are starting to be displayed in that, and you're going to be set off to use that gift somewhere else. And it doesn't mean that they can see each other. They might still get together during the week and compare notes. You know, they're doing it pretty much the same thing. So this is why I say more small churches where everyone can plug in and serve in their area of gift because more people with the New Testament church model than a mega church of thousands of people. That's really in keeping with the New Testament model. That's what we're now, if you get together, if you've ever been in a place where corporate worship is happening and there's 10,000 people in the place, and you're not in a place to speak out, there's a group. There is something really cool and nice about that church. But it doesn't have to be everything. It could be something that they know that they know. That's why it's not like that room for the gifts to be explained. So, a small fraction of people would be doing all the work in that mega church. Christians would have pastors to be raised. Introduced to somebody that came to the books of the New Testament. Heavenly Father, thank you for the word. Thank you for the Holy Spirit's teaching and making us understand. Thank you for our salvation being a free gift to us. It wasn't free, it cost too much, but you gave it to us. Thank you for that. We're very grateful. We're very encouraged. Freeness of the gospel of our salvation is a very important thing. And your grace is a great thing. And so we need to show forth that and say, we're going to say to you that you're supposed to be those grace for the people that you close by your word and show others that it's not about actual religious rules, but that it's about a relationship with Christ. Thank you so much for all of this. That's huge. Just thanks for having me.